Thank you. I'll try again. Thank you. This is Human Services Committee. I'm the Chairman Judy Hopkins, and the first order of business will be roll call. Thank you.
Mrs. Hopkins?
Here.
Mrs. Burdick? Mr. Barnes?
Present.
Mr. Decker?
Here.
Mr. Havey?
Here.
Mrs. Rue?
Here.
Mr. Stockin?
Here.
Mr. Crandall?
Here.
Seven members present, one absent.
Thank you very much. The next order of business is to approve the minutes of May 5th, 2021. Motion by Mrs. Root, second by Mr. Stockin. Any questions or corrections about those minutes? If not, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Thank you. Our first report of the day will be from Tyler Shaw, Public Health Director. Tyler, thank you for joining us today. We'll let you get your mic set there.
Good afternoon.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Monthly report highlights. Right now, lead cases are up compared to this time last year. We had 17 cases we were managing in April of 2020. And right now we're up to 45. So that is quite the increase in our workload. Communicable disease investigations, you'll see COVID-19 tests. That 14,000 number is not what Allegheny County itself has conducted. That is, if they go to WellNow and Olean or another provider, those are counted in our numbers as well. I am happy to report that this year we still have no positive rabies specimens that we collected, which is a pretty odd year. We usually have at least one, so hopefully that means that people are not coming into contact with rabid animals. That's always a good thing.
Yeah, it's only June 2nd. But.
Yes. Any questions on the monthly report?
Any questions from the floor?
Madam?
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about the vaccine clinics within the school districts, how it's going, numbers and so forth?
Sure. So we put out a press release, 423 students, faculty, and staff were vaccinated at the various school districts. That did encompass every school district but one. That includes some of our private school districts as well. And we are making arrangements for the last one to complete that.
Just to follow up, have you been experiencing any instances where, say, high schoolers would like to get the vaccine, but they're unable to get permission from their parents to do so?
Not that we've seen, but we do understand that there's always going to be those individuals where the parents want to be present while their child is vaccinated. So we're having some clinics here at the health department as well to capture those individuals.
Thank you.
Tyler, I just wanted to ask you kind of an overall COVID vaccination situation right now. Can you give us an update on where we're at in terms of percentages and number of people that have been vaccinated that you have records of?
Sure. So I've looked at the vaccine dashboard, and right now we do have some communities in the 65 and over population that are 100% vaccinated. So we have various zip codes in that. Alfred, Houghton is pretty close. They're at about 80% in that zip code. Almond is about 79%. So we do have some communities that are in that age category that are fully vaccinated. We do have in the 15 plus category, that's where our numbers kind of drop off, obviously, because 12 plus just recently was approved. So we're increasing those numbers. I am happy to report our community clinics were fully attended. Every appointment was filled. And we've seen a 3% increase typically on each of those zip codes where we specifically targeted and had those community clinics. So that's happy news. We're seeing an increase in percentages for those specific zip codes.
Good. And just in terms of upcoming clinics, so you're still having regular clinics, and what after school is out, you probably won't be having any at schools, will you? Or will you continue those in the summer as well?
Good question. That was kind of our full court press. That's why everything kind of rapidly unfolded with the schools. We wanted to make sure we gave those students that were interested in schools, because we knew what they were going to be at that specific place. We wanted to make sure we got the Pfizer there so that the second dose occurred while school was still in session. So we're going to get by on the skin of our teeth on a week before their sessions end. We will still have summer clinics for those students that, you know, mom, dad, guardian wants to bring them in. We'll still have those clinics going on as well. We do have two upcoming Pfizer clinics. Brenda just released that press announcement coming up on, I believe it's the June 10th and June 18th. So we do have those. We'll be releasing our Moderna community clinics, which the next three communities we are looking at would be Black Creek, New Hudson area, Whitesville area, and Fillmore area.
Okay, great. And just to, I know that the statistics are still being put up on the web, but in terms of the overall illnesses now, how are we doing?
Our cases are down. We're not seeing instances like we were at the beginning of the pandemic where we're getting serious hospitalizations, serious illness. So there is hope that the vaccine is working, and our caseloads are down. Lower this, at least this week, I say that with a grain of salt. Every time I do say that, typically there's a small spike. So, but for right now, I think on Saturday we had two cases. On Sunday, I think there was none. And Monday we had one case. So, and actually today the hospital did report to us that there were no cases. So.
Oh, that's excellent. Good. It's good to know. Any other questions on Tyler's report before we move on?
Madam.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, one more.
Yes, sir.
I know I know we're on the clock.
That's okay. We're good.
Testing. Still and yet, every test that's administered down here gets sent to U of R, is that correct?
PCR test, yes.
Yeah. Yep. So those tests up in that lab, are they testing those for the variants that we've been reading about in the news?
I don't believe U of R is. It's New York State that plucks those random samples that they test for the variants.
And if they find variants that originate in Allegheny County, do they let you know?
Yes.
And have we seen any of those variants?
Not since the last report in Alfred there. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Mr. Barnes.
Yes. Question. It's kind of a personal question. I've had COVID and I had the J&J shot. I was in the hospital for a procedure last week, and they put the thing up my nose. How often do they have to do that? Because I got another procedure next week, and they said they've got to do it again. So
typically, before any procedure, they just want to make sure that you're not bringing anything in. Again, vaccines aren't 100% effective, but you have a good possibility that you're not going to have COVID. But yeah, usually before every procedure.
And my second question is, have we had any situations in the county where a vaccinated person has come down with COVID?
We've had a few breakthrough cases. We investigating some of those. I think we only had two so far investigating those. One was a rapid test and they didn't do a follow-up PCR, which is customary. If you have no symptoms, you're getting a rapid test, you could have a false positive. They didn't go for follow-up. So we're attributing it to that, but it could be certainly they could have COVID. And the other one was a similar instance. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. We thank you for your diligent work, your staff as well during this time. And hopefully we are seeing a light at the tunnel. Okay, the next order of business is to the request to accept and appropriate funds from the Allegheny County Foundation.
Okay, so we applied for a grant through the Allegheny County Area Foundation for PPE supplies, and we would like to appropriate that accordingly.
Okay, any motion? Mrs. Rue? Second? Mr. Habe? Okay, discussion, questions? If not, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Thank you. Just a quick question, Tyler.
Sure.
You know, there was a time when we didn't have very many PPEs. How is our stockpile now?
We're doing okay.
Okay.
Yeah, we're still in the process of getting some other things shored up especially before school starts back up again in the fall. And we're still taking requests from various agencies across the county.
That's great. We certainly don't want to be lacking in there. Good. Okay. Thank you. Okay. The next order is to a request to transfer funds.
So This request is for our reproductive and sexual health program, or the family planning program. These funds are requested to be moved so that we can spend out the grant, and we do need some of these supplies as well for some of our nursing staff.
Okay. I see you're looking for laptops and docking station monitor,
yep,
things like that. So, okay, we need a motion to start that. Mr. Stockin, second. Mr. Decker, thank you. Any questions about that? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Okay, next order, Tyler.
Okay, next is the approval of service provider and evaluation contracts for our preschool program. On the MOE, I have some music therapists, speech language pathologists, and some center-based program provider contract. So looking for approval of that.
Okay, need a motion to start. Mr. Havey, second by Mr. Decker. Thank you. Okay, yes. Any questions about this?
Madam.
Yes, Mr. Harris.
I hope I'm on the right one here. We're talking about music therapists, speech language pathologists. Yes.
Correct.
So you bill insurances for the 59.5%. Does that include Medicaid or no?
It does. We can recoup 59.5% of whatever insurance doesn't cover.
Recoup from the state?
Yes.
Okay. So if the insurance doesn't cover it, the state pays it, or it gets kicked to Medicaid?
We have to bill Medicaid first, and then whatever Medicaid wouldn't pick up, then could bill the state 59.5%. Is
okay.
What I understand it to be.
Okay, so if Medicaid pays up, then it goes through the regular Medicaid channels.
Correct.
And we're responsible for that portion as well.
Yes.
Okay.
Whatever's left over. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any questions about the providers being nominated here or requested? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Thank you, Tyler. Next one.
Okay, next on the agenda is the request to fill a public health sanitarian position due to an anticipated retirement. We do have an individual who's been with the county 30 plus years looking to retire next week. So we are looking to fill that position. This is in the Environmental Health Division of the Health Department, and right now those activities are skyrocketing. This is our busy time of the year. So to go down a staff member is going to take quite a hit for our department. We do already have one vacant position as the environmental health director that is vacant. So we're hoping to limit the amount of vacancies we have in that department.
Okay, thank you. Motion by Mrs. Root, second by Mr. Havey. Questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Yes, Mr. Stockin.
Pretty sure we're on the same page here, but I talked to that gentleman this morning, met him on the sidewalk that's retiring. And over the years in his business and mine, I've had many interactions, and he's always been a real credit to your department. I'm sorry, I told him I wished he was just signing up, not leaving.
Me too. It's a lot of knowledge out the door. Yeah.
Good. How man. Many years has he been with it?
I want to say 32.
Wow. A lot of knowledge. That's good. Thank you for sharing that, Mr. Stockin. Okay, I think the vote was completed, so I think we can say that motion has passed. Thank you. Okay, and then the next one, Tyler, a public health technician.
Yep, we're requesting to fill a public health technician position. If you remember, I brought a second sanitarian that retired. They were hired around the same time, so they both retired around the same time, and due to a promotion. So we have a vacancy in the technician position due to one of our technicians being promoted to one of the sanitarian positions.
Okay. Thank you. So we'll need a motion. Mrs. Root, second. Mr. Havey, questions? Yes, Mr. Decker.
So Tyler, you've covered the sanitarian position with a technician, and now you're looking for a technician.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, yeah. I brought a sanitarian request to fill. We had another retirement. I filled that one with a technician. They got promoted. Yep. Now I'm looking to backfill that. Yep.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Thank you. And one more request.
Okay, last on the list, I have a request to fill two temporary office aide positions. As you know, at the beginning of the pandemic, we had a bunch of office aide positions and some funding from the federal government to cover these positions. I did have one resignation of one office aide position, and I have one office aide slash full-time county employee that's working their weekends. So I'm looking to give them a break and hire two office aides to cover that work.
Okay. So I know that we did get the positions, the opportunity extended until August, but you're not looking to go past June 30th?
The current grant is June 30th, 2022. However, there is a grant in the making that's going to extend that probably until 2023, but we don't have any award funding yet for that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll need a motion to start that. Mr. Stockin, second by Mr. Havey. Questions? Yes, Mr. Grace.
Basically, they're going to be paid out of that grant?
Yes.
For a year? What are the plans beyond that? Or?
That's it. That's all the funds we have. Unless that contract gets extended, then I can bring that back to the committee.
And Tyler, you were mentioning to me earlier that the responsibilities that these people can do has been expanded by the federal government. Can you just speak to that? Because
sure.
It was very narrow when they first started.
Yeah, it was very narrow. They could only do contact tracing, answering phone calls, basic office aid work. Right now, with the new contract coming forward, they can help in vaccination efforts, public outreach programs. It's expanded into basic clerical functions, answering various requests, scheduling appointments for vaccine clinics. That's really where we're going to get our assistance is the vaccine effort. I mean, that's been a heavy lift for most of our staff. Our nurses are almost working every single day still, trying to get the vaccines out the door. So this would be a welcome help.
Mm-hmm. Somebody needs to be still back answering the phones.
Yes.
While everybody else is out at the vaccination clinic.
Yep.
So, right. Okay. Can we do the motion? Okay, if there are not any more questions, we'll vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. That motion is passed. Okay, anything else you need to share with us today, Tyler?
That's it.
Okay, well, thank you very much for coming.
Madam Chairman, I have one
more
Decker? Question. What percentage of the population is vaccinated in Allegheny County?
Just a rough estimate, we're just over 40%. That's all age groups across all age categories.
Are we still experiencing difficulties getting enough vaccine to do more like
No.
we were earlier?
No, not the supply. We have all three vaccines right now. Some of the vaccine, Pfizer, for example, start of the pandemic, you could only have ultra freeze, which we don't have that capacity. So that limited our inventory. But that the Pfizer has recently changed. Now we can store that Pfizer vaccine in regular refrigeration for up to a month. So it gives us a little bit more flexibility.
That's
so it's opened up. We were piloting our community clinics last week, and they were very well attended. So that seems to be the model that we're going to move forward with.
Okay.
Question for Mrs. Ruth.
I want to follow up on Dave's question. That 40% number, does that include all the people who were in Florida who got vaccinated before they came home? How do you know if somebody went outside of the county and got vaccinated? I know people who went to Buffalo, people who went to Olean, some people got them before they came back. Does that include those people? How do you know
if
that 40% is correct?
That's a good question. If they're New York State, vaccinated by a New York State provider, they're supposed to be dumped into our account. So they would give their home address. The zip code would talk. Those systems in the state talk. If you got vaccinated in Pennsylvania, Florida, Connecticut, those systems don't talk. If you're vaccinated by the VA, those systems
don't talk
either. Yeah.
Because I know a lot of people got vaccinated
yep.
at the VA. If you went to a drugstore, is that into the state system?
Should be, yes. They are. If you're a vaccine provider in New York State, you are mandated to dump that.
So wouldn't you think that 40% really is higher than 40%?
A little bit, yeah.
Then
absolutely.
Why do we keep saying 40%?
I just said around 40%.
Well, and I think that's coming from Albany.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's not, I don't think it's a true picture.
Well, we certainly have found all through COVID that even the hospitalizations and things like that was never accurate because they were reporting to different places and our numbers were different than the
yeah.
states. So I believe Mr. Barnes has a question too.
Yes. Again, on the 40%, that's total from birth to death.
All eligible age groups, yeah.
So do you have an idea of those over 65, for instance, what percentage?
We're sitting just over 60% of that age category. And there's some, again, some zip codes that are 100% in that eligible population that are vaccinated. Yep. So we're not doing too terrible in some of those zip codes.
And what's the youngest in Allegheny County that a child can get the vaccination?
12 right now with Pfizer.
12.
Yep.
That's with just the Pfizer.
Just Pfizer.
The only one that's been approved.
Otherwise, it's 18 and up for Moderna and Johnson & Johnson. Yep.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Any other questions for Mr. Tyler? Okay. Thank you, Tyler, for
coming.
Thank you. Okay. Appreciate it. Next on the agenda is a report from the Office of the Aging from Anita Madison. Anita is not able to be here today, nor anyone from her office. So I would encourage you to look at that report and contact her if you do have any questions before next month. So thank you. So we will move ahead to report from our Social Services Commissioner, Edna Kays, who is here. Thank you for coming, Edna.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
If you look at our report, their numbers seem par for the course, is what I'd say. But I did want to let you know that the Blue Fund grant that we applied, we sent a letter of interest last month. You allowed us to send a letter of interest for that, and that was denied. We were denied the ability to apply for that grant. But with lots of compliments about our program, which I'm sure is what generally happens when you apply. So we are going to keep searching, and hopefully we'll find a grant that will help us with our capital projects. So although our second year grant from OVS does allow us to work on the house in the ADA areas, so the bathroom and the handicap ramp, we'll be able to at least start working on those. And with the Child Advocacy Center, we are waiting again for the approval of our second year budget so that we can buy the medical supplies that we need so that we can move forward and start doing our medical evaluations within the center. But we are ready. We have our nurses and we have our doctors, so we are ready, and they are already on board, and they're certainly providing advice and evaluations where they can. So as soon as that budget gets approved, we'll be able to move that forward full force. Looking forward to that. Any questions on the report?
Anybody from the floor? No? Okay. Thank you, Edna. We'll move along to the approval of the legal assistance contract.
So that we are requesting that a resolution to approve a contract with Law New York out of Bath. We are required to have this contract. What it does is it provides representation for Allegheny County residents who have been denied Social Security disability or supplemental security income, SSI, so that they can have representation when they're trying to look for fair hearing to be able to get their benefits.
Okay, all right. Yes, motion by Mr. Havey, second by Mrs. Root. And are there some questions from the floor? Mr. Graves.
I don't see, physical impact, 5,000. It's there, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, just wondering how it's going to get paid.
Yep. Yes. Yes.
Okay, Mr. Barnes.
You talked about denied Social Security benefits. If they're denied, what reason would they have to go someplace else to try to get the benefits? I'm a little confused as to why that exists. In other words, if somebody applies to the Social Security for a particular benefit, and they're denied, they can go someplace else and get approved, or how's that work?
No, so what the attorney does is they help them to go back and approach Social Security to try to get those benefits. And in the meantime, the department will open a temporary assistance case and help with their monthly needs. And then at the time that they receive Social Security benefits, whether it be supplemental security income or Social Security disability, that money would be paid back to the department for the money that we help them with. But it is not uncommon to see folks be denied. They might be missing an appropriate doctor's evaluation, or they, for a Social Security supplemental security income, they might need like a mental health evaluation, and it might not have exactly what it needs in it, so they might be denied that first time, and they might need legal assistance to help them with that effort to get those benefits.
No. Bottom line is, if a person's denied, they can go back with legal help to try to.
Yes.
If they're denied again, how does the county's?
Well, the legal help would still be there. The legal help would still be there for them.
But if it's denied again, their possibility of getting those that help from the Social Security is no longer available then, right?
You know, I can't really tell you how many times that people have been denied. I have seen many people be denied the first time and then get it the second time they've applied. I can't really speak to a lot of the
second
denial.
I guess what I'm looking at is welfare fraud, where does that enter in there at all? Are people applying for benefits that they're really not entitled to, but if they get denied and then they come back and they get legal help, we pay for legal help to try again, they're denied because it was considered fraudulent.
So the Social Security does their own fraudulent investigations. And if that's the case, then they would be denied, and then we would have to figure out how to do we would have to figure out what their eligibility is for temporary assistance going forward, or if we needed to put that forward to our own fraud department to see if they're being fraudulent with temporary assistance, as we call it. Does that make sense?
Sort of. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that question. Any other questions? Okay, if not, we'll take a vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that motion is passed. Thank you. And the last order of business for you is to receive some CARES Act funds.
So this is CARES Act funding. I think we talked a little bit about this last month, about the Emergency Rental Assistance Program. For folks that have not been able to pay their rent in the last year since March 13th of 2020. This money is being appropriated to help pay for the advertisement of that program. The portal did open yesterday. There have been some difficulties with the portal, but hang in there and keep trying. They're trying to fix those issues at this point in time. But the portal will help people pay their rent that they haven't been able to pay in the last year. As you know, or if you remember, I shared that the landlord has to be a part of that to get that money. The money would go directly from from New York State. It's federal funding from New York State to the landlord. If the landlord's not involved, they will hold on to the money. If the person is eligible for the money, they'll hold on to the money for 180 days, hoping that the landlord will also join in the process and be able to get that money. So that is there. You'll see soon, we'll be putting out some advertising. We're going to be meeting about that this week so that people in the county are aware of that. I did receive a call today from a message from a lady today who's having difficulty with it, with the portal, but hang in there. Their state is working feverishly to fix the portal so that people can continue to apply.
Okay. We just need a motion first, Mr. Fanton, and then we'll take questions. Mrs. Root, motion, second. Mr. Decker, thank you. Okay, Mr. Fanton has a question.
Yeah, so basically this money, this 120, is for us to monitor and do outreach. It's not to pay the rent.
No.
So we're just kind of the go-between.
We're the go-between. We're advertising. We'll help people fill out the applications within the portal. Yep, that's what we're going to do.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Mr. Barnes.
So if I'm a renter and I haven't been able to pay the rent because of the COVID situation, I can get help.
Yes.
What about if I'm a homeowner and I need help with my mortgage? Is there any program for that?
I have not seen anything on the mortgage.
So if you don't own a house, you can get help, but if you own a house, you're not eligible for help, is what you're saying.
Well, let me say this. My department probably wouldn't help you if you owned a house. I cannot speak to you on back mortgage. I don't know that at all.
You own part of a house if you're paying a mortgage. But,
true.
It just seems that if there's help for one group of people, there ought to be help, at least temporary help.
I don't disagree with that at all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Root.
I just want to follow up on Dwight's question to you. This $120,000 is for advertising?
Basically advertising, and it's not, none of it is going to be used toward stipends at all. We said the same thing to the state, $120,000 for advertising and getting the word out there, and that's what they're sending.
Wow. Yeah. Just look at that amount of money for advertising for this program, folks.
Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
But that doesn't mean that we couldn't help with the portal, right? Maybe get a computer or something to sit down with folks to help fill that information out. But yes, we were quite surprised at that amount.
Well, I'm just reading the MOE here again, and it says that to use for outreach for eligible households and assist them in applying for rental arrears payments. So it seems like there would be some money involved in that part of it,
yes.
Insisting.
And every county likely received a similar award, if not more.
Yes.
And
the bigger the county, the bigger the award.
And our media is the same as Steuben or Cattaraugus County. Our outreach will likely be going to the same places too, correct?
Yes.
And that was an issue we had with our census outreach, is that every county received an award to do outreach, but there's only so many places to do outreach. There's a lot of duplication. So
I see billboards in our future.
Okay, yes, Mr. Grace. Oh, I'm sorry, Mrs. Root, did you finish? Okay.
It's a simple question. Is there an ability in this $120,000 that we could bill for our services? You're going to have to use staff to do all this stuff.
So a lot of that work that's done through the department is done through Accord. And when I talked to Accord about it, they made it very clear that stipends is not an area that they need help.
So you won't be administering, it'll be Accord?
We will do it together.
And you have staff to take care of that? We're not going to have to hire someone?
No, I'm not asking you to hire anybody. Not for that, anyway.
Thank you.
Mr. Harris, sir.
Thank you. Seems like there'd be more incentive for a landlord to apply for reimbursement than for a tenant. Is the marketing solely focused on tenants who are behind on the rent?
No. So we have pulled together the landlord list that we all know, so that we can do a mailing or send out to them so that they know that it's there. I have personally sent out to the landlords that I know are having difficulty with the rental moratorium. Another incentive is that if the moratorium is lifted and a landlord tries to take somebody, legal action on somebody, the court would say to them, have they applied for this? Because that kind of nullifies their bringing action against the tenant, because this is available and ready to use.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, I think we're ready for a vote then. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Thank you. Okay, and anything else you'd like to add, Edna?
Not today.
Okay, thank you for coming.
Thanks. Have a good day.
Okay. We have one other order of business, an appointment to the Board of Health. This is for a six-year term for Dr. Willard L. Simons. His term expires this July 7th. This would be a six-year appointment lasting from July 8th, 2021, expiring July 7th, 2027. So we need a motion to accept that. Mr. Habey, a second by Mrs. Root. Okay, any discussion or questions about this? Okay, I know that Dr. Simons has been on the board for a number of years and an experienced member. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion is passed. Thank you. Is there any old business today? Any new business? Anything for the good of the order? I would take a motion for adjournment then.
Madam Chairman, if there's no further business to come before the committee, I move we adjourn.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. Second by Mr. Stockin. Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you very much.